And welcome back to our second session on investment cases. And we have four more very exciting cases. But the first one here I'm thrilled about because Hilvard here, he actually helped us with the sustainable brand when we started off the company. And I'm very excited to hear what he has to say. And he's for sure a creative soul. I've seen him in real life. And Hilvard, take it away.
Thank you, Bo. Thank you. Yes. First of all, thank you for being here. I just want to start by saying I think this is a good day to be talking to you about ReVirtue, a new talent platform that seeks to redefine the creative industry from the inside out. My name is Hildred Werleman, and in the coming moments, I will explain to you why ReVirtue goes way beyond being just a platform. And before I get to that, I also want to say that I think my presentation is a bit different compared to what has been so far, because I think ReVirtue's directive comes from a very empathic point of view, a very human point of view. So I hope you enjoy this journey. As we know at the moment, the creative industry is notoriously exploitative, pushing creatives to very desperate situations, surviving from gig to gig. It's been normalized, creatives being underpaid or not paid at all. So being a creative myself, I can also relate to this on a very real way. The creative industry is also one of the hardest hit at the hands of the ongoing crisis. And we see that career and income inequality is exponentially higher than any of the other industries out there. We also see creatives being pitted against one another in a very opportunistic and self-serving environment, which is also why I started to think about how can we create a space where creativity can prosper. The stress of these situations is pushing a lot of creatives to keep inside of them a lot of untapped creative potential. But as we can start seeing as what we need right now as a society, creativity is going to play a very important role by pushing forward innovation in a new direction. As you can see there as well, it's being pointed out, creativity, sustainability, and impact. Why has creativity been undervalued and overlooked? Look at the examples of our ancestors. They had to think creatively to move forward. They had to think in different ways to get out of the box, to advance, to lead the way to a better tomorrow for their people. So here we started to think, why then is creativity treated as a secondary skill? We see, yes, there's a lot of technology, there's a lot of innovation right now, but there's also a lot of things that we don't need. So we started to, I started to think in infrastructures. How can we build a new paradigm, a new reality where creators can actually focus on doing transformative work? And according to Adobe, leading employees are actually acknowledging that creativity is a critical and necessary skill for the job market. And also, it's a fact that creativity, originality, and initiative is the number three in-demand skill when it comes to the job market in the year 2022, according to the World Economic Forum. Having this in mind, I started thinking, okay, how can we give a space where creativity can prosper? A new self-sustaining talent economy, how powerful would that be? At ReVirtue, we pledge to give creativity not just a decent salary, but a central and valuable role in an environmentally and socially constructed new reality where it is customary to invest in creative intelligence. We use technology to work for creativity instead of killing it. We are creating a safer and fairer space for recently graduated creatives, aspiring creatives, or basically people that have given up on their dreams to actually focus on making transformative work. Because creativity goes beyond design, creativity goes beyond colors and composition. Creativity on its core is about problem solving. Solving really real problems with true creativity. So, yeah. think there's a lag. But being on Revertu will be like having your very own AI assistant. Our matchmaking algorithm does not only match you to openings based on your skills, but they're also being matched by your personal values and the company culture. Automated contracts, in-app valuation systems, integrated peer-to-peer payment systems, and the ability to bypass red tape and geographical limitations are only a few of the tools ensuring a healthy ecosystem of mutually beneficial collaborations. Companies and organizations and recruiters on Revertu stand out by being a part of a new economy that values the true potential of creativity. To frame Revertu's directive within the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, Revertu will focus on reducing inequalities, industry innovation and infrastructure, and providing decent growth and economic decent work and economic growth. Meaning that creativity on Revertu will be pulled to as a propeller for change. Our talent platform tends, other talent platforms tend to commodify creativity and always put a price tag, putting them in a self-serving environment. At Revertu, we don't try to mold creativity because we see the potential on untamed creative potential. We do this because we don't want creators to lose their peculiarity. We see a lot of brands and companies failing to stand out in these design bubbles, recycle design ideas, because creators are being seen as commodities. Revertu provides a new angle. Right now, we are focusing on our crowdfunding campaign, which I would like to answer some questions later on. And to celebrate this, I just wanted to share with you our newest pitch video, which is part of this crowdfunding campaign.
Creatives, listen up. Why are there so many of us, but still so isolated? This is our chance to build a new, more equal playing field for ourselves, because nobody else will. Together, we can create a safer space where we can thrive as a community. Let's be honest, it sucks right now. We live in a world where surviving from gig to gig has been normalized. As creatives, we have been pitted against one another by primitive algorithms and dying economies. Undervalued, we are left in desperate situations, bursting with untapped creative potential. Enough! The time has come to take charge of our own prospects. Let's claim back the benefits of our creative power by stepping into a new reality where creativity is valued. We can no longer allow ourselves to be treated as a resource to be commodified. At Revertu, we get this. We seek to empower and reunite our community by building a platform that will eradicate career inequality, income vulnerability, and moral hazards within the creative industries. Our cognitive matchmaking algorithm will not only link you to job opportunities that fit your skill set, but also align with your personal values and principles as a creator. While other talent platforms exploit creativity and try to mold us into conformity, being on Revertu will be like having your own personal assistant that truly amplifies your untapped creative potential. Our rights and voices will be protected by automated contracts and integrated peer-to-peer payment systems. The possibilities are boundless. Just try to imagine a new self-sustaining economic ecosystem made by and for creators, where we can determine our own rules and possibilities. We can be unstoppable. Meet Revertu's growing team. We are working hard towards a new status quo for creators, united by our belief in creativity, fueled by the inspiration of the many eclectic voices of our community. We need your help to build a future we all deserve. Thanks to you, creatives barely surviving in a capitalist society will soon become a thing of the past. Feel what is intrinsic. Be a part of the change we need. Become a backer today to help develop the Revertu platform. Every contribution brings us one step closer to creative freedom and financial independence. See you on the other side.
Thank you. No doubt, Hilvard, that you are kind of leading the creative economy. And actually, we're now in the place where we had some years ago Trailer Park Festival with the Space 10 now and the Art Rebels. And I think you are kind of the new generation of the creatives. Tell us a little bit more about the business model, or how are this platform, because definitely you are talented, but how are this platform supposed to make money?
Yes. So the platform and our business model is designed in a way to create less barriers for creatives, less stress for creatives. So creatives won't have the limitations of a subscription. Joining the platform as creatives will always be free, to not add another stressor to what already creativity is suffering as a craft. The business model will be run mostly on subscription on the company side. That is very, very viable for companies, especially startups, because we see a lot of potential in startups and their impact and how easily their organization can be reorganized. We're also talking about a revenue stream on tokenized actions on the platform that will be hidden sources of streams, valuation systems, when a digital art piece is being valuated or reshared or bought, these kind of transactions to kind of, you know, minimize the, you know, financially heavy and capital intensive focus on being a part of this new economy.
And you are now running an Indiegogo campaign, and there will be revenue through the platform. Other sources of funding you're looking into, what you do?
Yeah, so basically for this part of the funding, we are putting a high importance on crowdfunding because we want to generate a sense of ownership in the community, being able to say, hey, we are on the same boat. We want to give you the chance to invest in your future, to create this sort of, you know, tribe mentality in a way to say, hey, we have to take charge of about this because nobody else will, you know, pay attention to us or build this for us. Of course, we have looked into other viable forms of funding, which we already have been contacted by several you know, firms here in Denmark that are very interested to follow our journey at the moment. And of course, we are also focusing our efforts in the coming period of funding to look into you know, public funding. We want to you know, extend a sense of autonomy and having control over, okay, so what is going to be this economy? How are we going to shape it? And that is not always the case with private funding. So we are, you know, working in stages when it comes to that to keep true the idea.
I understand. If there's any questions, otherwise I have a last one. You start in Copenhagen, I guess, or tell us about how you will expand from here where we stand now.
Yes, so actually ReVirtue started in the concept phase in Amsterdam, Netherlands. It started in a very, you know, a graduation kind of a community of creatives, that a focus group thinking about, you know, the main pains, the, you know, the potential. And then afterwards, I brought it with me to Copenhagen, where it's officially registered, and we started expanding the team in that. I'm also developing it further in the academic context of the Royal Danish Academy to, you know, make use of the resources and the context in a way to expand. And I think our focus market-wise would, of course, be the Nordics, Scandinavia, most of all. Half of our team is in Helsinki, so it's happening on a very organic way, how the word is spreading within the creative community. And obviously, of course, Central Europe, because of Amsterdam, where it all started. But our ambitions go globally. It's a decentralized economy that is, you know, created by and for creatives outside of, you know, the traditional financial infrastructures, in a way to lower those hazards.
Okay, so if you want to be a first row in the creative economy, please follow ReVirtue, and you can invest in them online and for the future. Thank you very much, Hilvard.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now we're jumping to a new field. I must say, I have heard a lot about cashew, but I haven't tasted them, so I'm very much looking forward. But please tell us about it and take it away, Marianne.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Marianne, and I'm the founder of Cashew. And we turn waste from small-scale cashew nut farmers into caramels. So what very few people are aware of is that on top of every single cashew nut we eat, there's actually a fruit that's up to 10 times the size of the nut itself. Each year, more than 16 million tons of these fruits are wasted on the African continent. And more than half of all the cashew nuts globally consumed are actually produced by African smallhold farmers. And it seems quite illogical that all of these fruits are just wasted on the fields. But imagine if these farmers could actually increase their income and create local jobs by using these resources that they actually already have available. And that's exactly what Cashew wants to help them with. We want to support the farmers in harvesting and processing this cashew fruit and turn it into a stable fruit paste, which we then can use in our plant-based cashew fruit caramels. And we launched these caramels on co-op crowdfunding in October last year, where we got fully funded within 6 hours, and we funded more than 130,000 Danish crowns within the 2 months. And then we have also just been nominated as a finalist for the product competition Solorgudjem. And just to tell you a little bit more about how it's working, so we support these, or enable the farmers to actually harvest and collect these fruits by providing training and lending equipment for the collection. Then we take the fruits to a processing facility, the cashew nut processing facility, where they turn the fruits into this stable fruit paste, which is then shipped to Denmark, where we produce these caramels. And we have two partners, which are cashew nut factories in Ghana and in Tanzania. And they here we have already done the first batches of the cashew fruit paste. And then we have a production and sales partner, Social Foodies, where we are currently producing the caramels. And we'll mainly sell these caramels for retail. And we'll start with the original flavor, and then we will follow with some other flavors, such as licorice. And they will be sold for 39 kroners per 60 grams. And then the second revenue stream will come from B2B collaborations, where we'll sell the fruit paste to other food companies that can use this fruit paste because of its flavor or its high nutritional values or in other products. And we have already tested some products such as ice cream and these flødeboller and some oat bars. And we know that there's a huge trend for upcycled food. 59% of all Danish consumers are actually motivated to reduce food waste. And the global upcycled food industry has been valued to more than 280 billion Danish crown and has a predicted annual growth rate of 5%. And we look at the Danish confectionery market that is valued to around 11 billion Danish crowns. And just targeting 2% of the people that are either partly or fully vegetarian, we have a potential market value of 40 million. And a little bit about me. It all started for me in 2018 when I was writing my thesis in Tanzania about the cashew nut value chain. So this was the first time that I saw a cashew fruit, and I realized the huge waste there is in this industry, and I decided to do something about it. So I spent a long time experimenting with different ways to upcycle these fruits, and came up with these caramels. And right now, we are developing the new packaging concept, which are these squares, and trying to get ready to get the product in retail. And we just bought a caramel machine so we can actually scale the production. And then we're doing a project in Tanzania to install some local processing units to also scale the production of the cashew fruit paste and other crops. Yeah, so I'm looking for a partner that can help me with this local production in Tanzania and also with the marketing and sales of these caramels. That's it. And we also just went live on co-op crowdfunding together with Boa Vida about this local processing unit for cashew fruits and coconuts. So you can go and get some caramels on co-op crowdfunding, or you can get them inside at our little table.
Thank you, Marianne. And I just tasted them; they are delicious. So, congratulations!
Thank you.
And they're small. Yeah, so incredible journey you have been on, and the whole value chain. So isn't it difficult to both be on in Africa dealing with production and the whole value chain and retail? So tell us a little bit about where's your strength or where are you improving yourself today?
Yeah, definitely it has been, there has been some challenges in just finding out the best way to process this fruit, because one of the main challenges is that the shelf life of these fruits is really short. So we need to process them locally, and finding out how the best way is to process this, it has been kind of, yeah, a lot of different ideas and kind of now just focusing on this kind of fruit paste. We also did a lot of experiments with finding like if we can extract other things from the fruits, such as pectin. But now we're just focusing on this kind of, it's kind of a very low-tech solution. And I think that has made it easier now to actually scale up, because we can use the facilities that they actually have for the cashew nut, that they use for the cashew nut factories. So in that sense, yeah, it's been difficult to be there and here, but since the process is kind of simple, we have been able to tell our production partners how they should produce it, and they have actually done a great job. So,
Yeah, and it seems like they are both the cashew caramels and your crowdfunding is going like fire. So can you tell us about your future plans ahead, like 3 years, or what's the future look like for you?
Oh, 3 years, that's a long time. but yeah, so like short term, we have the getting those caramels to the retail. But then yes, as I said, so I want to also focus on the B2B. So looking more into how can we actually make the cashew fruit flavor a more known flavor. Like looking at mango 10 years ago, no one in Denmark was having a mango ice cream, right? So trying to see how we can introduce this new flavor to the European market and maybe see it in a lot of products in 5 or 10 years, right?
So ice cream and...
Everything.
Everything.
Yes.
Yeah, go nuts. Right?
Yeah.
So any questions from the audience? Yeah?
Yes, you use the whole fruit, no?
Yes. Yes,
because in outside normally you know the I don't know the top,
yeah,
like this the seed for the it looks like nuts, yeah, but is the fruit completely the fruit that you use?
Yeah, so it's
yeah, yeah, exactly.
So this is the nut and this. The kernel, with what you eat normally,
yeah, exactly.
It's actually only inside this one and also only one third of the nut
but
itself.
Because I am from Colombia, and this fruit is really important in Colombia as well, yeah, in the Caribbean. But I know not many people knows that all of the fruit you can eat.
Yes, you can eat it. But it's kind of, when you eat it without processing it, it's kind of a little bit dry because it has a lot of tannins. So I think also in Brazil and Colombia, you probably, when you make a juice, you remove the tannins and you make it more sweet.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. Okay, but for the caramels, you use all of the fruit?
Yes, we actually just take this fruit and we concentrate it.
Okay.
And we put it inside the caramels. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
And the investment for now, what's it going to be spent on exactly?
So the crowdfunding, we are focusing on actually buying some equipment to start processing cashew fruits. And also other crops. So we're also looking into the coconuts that are not used as much, and also maybe other fruits in the future, because those farmers, they have a lot of fruits and crops that are actually not processed, and therefore they don't really have a good market for it. So that's the first funding that we're raising for.
And are you seeking smart money or people with experience? Or I know you have a great team already, but...
yeah, definitely. I'm looking for also right now that I'm getting the product on the retail. I would like to get some help with that because I'm not really familiar in that
okay.
scene.
Yeah. Listen up, guys. If there's someone who would be interested, there's a good case here for sure. So please give a hand to Cashew and Marilyn.
Thank you.
staying a bit in the food business, and we have a expertise here, and you've been helping also, I heard just now from Cashew. Here we have a great company and an advisor to many things. Laila, please take it away.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here today and have this opportunity, so thank you very much. I'm Laila, I'm the founder of Boa Vida, and I have more than 30 years of experience in organic organic market and production. So we see here, I want to show you a little bit about my company and what I have been doing in Boa Vida. I am linking good produce with good people. That is mainly what I'm thinking. And I am very passionate about sustainable food system and socially fair and environmental friendly products. Also, I am working on establishing production in Tanzania to import goods to the West. And why I am doing that, I experience that we have a huge potential for organic products, and we have a huge lack in organic production and products in Europe and in the West. And actually in Tanzania we have so many lovely products, but the farmers there, they actually don't have a market for them. So how can we do a link with the farmers to the organic markets? Our vision is actually that we want to make a sustainable balance between producers and buyers. And that's why that we have actually an extremely unsustainable food production system nowadays. Of course, we work with the CDG's goals in our work all over. Our mission is that we are involved in the sustainable production in Tanzania and other places as well, but we are focusing in Tanzania. We work to link those organic food to the market, and we are focusing in sustainable grown food by small-scale farmers in Tanzania mainly, as I already told you. And I want to take out an example, and that is Frank. And Frank is my farmer, and that is my very, very good partner in Tanzania. He actually have land, 350 acres of land, and he just bought 100 acres more. He had been organic certified many years ago, but he dropped the organic certification because of many things. But actually we had the audit last week. So now next week we are going to have gain the organic certification for European markets. He is producing a lot of avocados. I cannot really deal in the organic in the avocados, but he have a production of honey and lovely pumpkin seeds and chilies as well. We have been investigating in how could we increase the irrigation system. So actually in those days, we also have some irrigation systems increased at one of the farms. And Frank, he succeeded 1 month ago to have so many money, so he himself could actually buy a cooler truck. So now we can transport some of the products from farms to a production site, which we built. And that is processing and packaging facilities. That is one more thing that we have been doing together. We have actually built a house down there. So now we can ensure that we are doing all the food things in the matter of food authorities. And we just also, 3 months ago, got the stamp for that. And organic certification as well. Frank, I love you. We also have a lot of other achievements. We actually have coconut oil processed already. And we actually successfully entered into the cosmetic market. I'm a person from the food, so that is a very good thing, I think. It's a huge, huge, huge market. And actually in the cashew nuts, as Marianne just told, we are together with Marianne in the cashew fruit, but we actually already buy the cashew nuts, and we already sold 35 tons. We already had the first container in Denmark, and that contains honey, 3 tons, pumpkin seeds, 500, and I can tell you what's written there. But actually what I want to tell you is that we actually sold everything before it came to Denmark. And what is the challenges in this business? The challenges is very practical. We have been investing in a deshelling machine for the pumpkin seeds. Actually, it's broken right now. So that is a very practical thing that we have to do. Sell crops in advance. That is a huge challenge, I think. All the time have to go and tell people in the market, hey, we have this lovely thing, and if you join, then we can scale up, and then we can actually produce these things, and we can sell it to you. And then the scaling up the production, that is a huge challenge as well. How do we invest at farm site so we can produce more than 500 pumpkin seeds? We need to produce 2 containers because we can sell it. So that is the challenges. Where are we now? We have been succeeded in many things, I think. We actually have this first container. We have the second container now on the ocean. And we have experienced that there is a huge interest in the pumpkin seeds and the honey. And we can scale up that production. That's for sure. How is the numbers in Boavita? We have been increasing since 2019, where I established the Boavita APS. And in 2019, I have this 250,000, in 2017, 715. And now we have the budget for 1.6 million. And actually, in the first quarter, we have the revenue of 470,000. I have been investing in this myself, $500,000, and I have been working without salary for 2 years. The team I have around me is also very important, except from Frank, my farmer. That is Marina. She is a SOMI director, managing. And Mons, he is actually having even more experience in the organic sector than me, 40 years. He's Danish. He is an organic farmer as his education, but he has been actually in the wholesaler sector for many, many years. He established a wholesaler company many years ago, and I have been joining him in that work, and that's where we have this very huge network in the organic market. Jane and Edwin is settled in Dar es Salaam. Jane is the one who actually produced the coconut oil, but she's also a marketing lady and very, very good to organize things. Edwin is also very good to organize, and he is actually focusing in how do we do a business in seeds in Tanzania. And we have educated Edwin, so now we are seeds importer in Tanzania as well. And I am seeking persons who can actually help me scaling up this business, because there is a huge possibility for that.
Thank you. Thank you, Laila. Thank you. I heard a lot about you also previously, and I know that you are definitely good for it. So, you are solving a lot of problems, right?
Yeah.
That's for sure. And I guess also, can you talk more about the things on the ground? Because I think Africa is far away, and it's difficult to imagine, the differences.
Yeah, yeah.
So what is it exactly? Because it's obviously, there's a lot of potential, right?
Definitely.
but as a few people like you with the knowledge,
yeah,
right,
yeah,
that can do it, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So can you explain us your magic?
Yeah.
What's the magic you can do?
What is my magic? I think one of the things that I have been succeeded in is actually to find the right partners in Tanzania. Frank, he is very adaptable to new knowledge. So when, for example, he go to, we have an organization, an NGO in organic farming in Tanzania, where he actually learned a lot in this. And then I think my experience in both in practical, I'm not a farmer myself, but I know something. So that I actually can go and be practical also together with my Frank here. We just keep on, stick to Frank. Yeah. That is one of the things. And then that I actually have a huge knowledge of the market. So I can actually buy the things if I have money for that. And I also know a lot of things. How can we, or what is needed to do at Frank's farm and in this process in packing house, so we ensure that the quality is high and all the food authorities' papers are well done and so on. That is what I can do.
So you make sure that it's ready for retail, that it's ready for that supermarket here these guys?
No, actually not. Maybe that was not clear, but yeah. I'm focusing in B2B.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I will not make a product. The cashew nut is not coming out to Coop or EMA.
Only if it's cashew.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And Social Foodies is one of my customers, and they repack it. Mm. I want to deliver pallets or containers. Mm. Yeah, because that's where the business is also. Not only for me, not only for me, for the farmers as well.
Yeah, I think we have a question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello, there is actually a question from an online viewer from Migle, and she's asking, how is it sustainable to transport the food for thousands of kilometers?
That is sustainable in that way that we cannot grow the quality of honey in Denmark like we can in Tanzania, and we kind of need those other kind of quality. And none of us here we want to live without limes and so the pumpkin seeds as well. So there are something in this corner of the world where we live that we want still. And how then we do it sustainable is actually to go back and make sure that it is sustainable in the socially way and of course in the environmentally way as well. But of course the transport, you can questioning that, but I think that we live in a world today that we have to do those things and make a difference out there also. Yeah.
You talked about scalability and you want to scale up. Is it you want the knowledge or you want the capital or both of it?
Actually, I would love the both.
Yeah. And what kind of experience
The
knowledge, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think I would love to join somebody who also have the experience in sales. Maybe a person who can add on my sales exactly. And and also I think there is so many things that I have to use my time on in organize the company. And now when we are growing, I need somebody joining me and make me better in that. But the capital is very important as well, because I all the time need to pay up front, and because otherwise the farmers cannot produce. And for example, with the irrigation, we need to install more irrigation so we can actually produce and harvest pumpkin seeds 3 times a year. At this time, we only can harvest 1 time a year. So a capital is needed as well.
The Danish farmers, do they have money, or how is that?
I don't know. The Danish farmer I'm together with?
Yeah, in general, if they're supporting your case.
You know, the Danish farmers, they are crying all the time, don't they? So I don't know.
We have a question for
you.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it is.
Det er bare sådan et fedt spørgsmål om crowdfunding. Det er bare
okay. Okay.
As Bo from High on Life, do you know him?
No.
So that's what to say. That's the first juice brand in Denmark. So he's the guy that you'll see on what is that called? Godmorgen Danmark. Is it still called that?
Yeah.
Every Saturday and Sunday.
Okay.
A big guy, and he have like a juice concept. I used to have a juice bar with him, but now it's only like a juice bar where they go out at the events and things like that.
Ah.
That might be something to consider because he's also making his own oil now and also like a green product, you know, with pulverized bygras, hvedegras, biolina, chlorella, all these things. That might be something interesting for you because I think he has managed to, check it out.
Okay, thank you.
Amazing. It's really here for business wise.
Yeah, exactly.
Really great.
Yeah.
We also have an investor with us, and recently there was actually a business case from Africa where they kind of announced, I think it went kind of IPO. They had, it was a music app.
Okay.
40 Danish investors from Denmark, like they understand music, like they saw Spotify, like I'm getting on the Spotify train for Africa, right? So there was 40. But maybe, Mikkel, this is like, we can understand this. It's like, there's a clear, like, she knows the market and there's big potential from the products. Is that something Danish investors, you think, from Danban would be interested in joining, you think?
Yeah, so I'm from Danban, or a member of Danban. I think your case is interesting because you have already made a lot of sales. What I would like to ask now would be something like your customers.
Mm-hmm.
How many customers do you have already?
Mm-hmm.
How sure are you that you can scale this? Do you have a lineup of customers to scale this, or is this something that you wish to see if you can achieve in the future?
Mm-hmm.
That would be. Yeah, first questions.
Okay. Yeah, I those do want me to name the customers that I have already, but
no names, but just how many?
How many?
Are you just selling to one?
No. Actually, I have a huge customer, but also no. Actually, I have more than one. I have some huge customers, and actually, they are asking for more products. If you could deliver 1 tons of honey tomorrow, we would like to have that. And then actually I also have huge organic wholesalers in the Netherlands that I am cooperating with them already now and delivering the cashew nuts for them. So they are interested to add on with my project as soon as I have containers. But it's not a contract sign, but you know that is the sales issues and challenges that you all the time have to keep the line warm. So that is what I'm doing. So I think I have quite good a network and promising customers for my products. Mm-hmm. And I think I can scale it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Last minute.
Yeah. So. Hello. So have you been talking to Vækstfonden about making some, of course, starts of Vækstlån, or made some, I'm not familiar with the English term, but in bankgaranti from Vækstfonden, yeah. Because what I think you need is a lot of working capital mm-hmm. and not earned capital that exactly. many startup businesses are looking for. Mm-hmm. So in that way, you are more interesting than firms with this mm-hmm. earn need. So that's very interesting. If you could set up a plan for, well, I need these money to make these next containers move, and then we will have a very short return of investment. That would be probably be a good business case.
But thank you very much. I have already told with Vækstfonden, and the problem is actually the bank guarantee. Yeah.
But maybe Mikkel can help with that, or some of his friends that always needs a lead investor. So thank you, Laila, and good luck with Boa Vita.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for your time.
And we are having here Simon with the final pitch, and we are looking very forward to how we can close off and get us all into a green transition with the flow rope. So take it away, Simon.
Yeah, last but I hope not least. I'm Simon, and I'm here to welcome you to the flow rope world. So I can change it here. I gotta get used to this. Okay, that's how it goes. Yeah, so at Flow Rope, we got this burning desire to make the fashion industry more sustainable by giving clothes new lives. Imagine that unlimited, pre-loved, secondhand fashion was only a swipe away. Imagine that it was easy to upload and sell, filter, buy and trade. And what if we cultivated a social environment with likes and comments, and could even follow our friends, along with always having an overview of our clothes and outfits right now, right here in the pocket. That's how we imagine the world's future digital and social wardrobe.
Oh yeah.
So, the problem. It's 2021, and sustainability, fashion, and e-commerce are trending like never before. But here in Denmark, we see that only about 10% trade secondhand online. That's a big issue for the children of tomorrow, when the consumption of just a single t-shirt pollutes like 2 hours of a hot shower or 30 meals with meat. Ain't it time that we start picking our fights? 7 of 10 Danes say they find the current platforms too hard and time-consuming, and secondhand shops like Red Cross and Salvation Army, they have failed to be digitalized for more than a decade now. Oh, sorry for that. our app is a digital and social wardrobe and marketplace for clothes trading. So you should imagine, let's say, Grailed or Trend Sales, just in the simple swipe format that we know from Tinder, with the auctions like at eBay, and all of the fun and social elements that we love from Instagram. Basically, this is everything that young people, modern mothers, senior volunteers, you and I didn't know we needed. Swipe your way through cool secondhand, upload clothes in uno momento with the backgrounds removed automatically. One moment. Oh yeah, so give leftovers new life in 24 hours or make a deal at auctions. Get 14 days of full return, enter your wardrobe from everywhere, see more of the products that you tend to like, get base pricing on data, and see your green environmental footprint and many other cool features. Oh yeah. So the marketing. Our marketing strategy is generally characterized by hype and storytelling. So if you go online, then you can meet our animated characters, Florian and Roberta. that help us with user education and to generally promote a sustainable and fashionable lifestyle. We will activate resellers and influencers to kickstart and make traction, along with the PR and media stunts. To really get the message out there, because this is a movement. Yup. Due to this competitive advantage that we will become a trading agency and not a platform like our competitors or colleagues, we have chosen to earn a service fee of 15 Danish crowns per purchase. Capturing just 5% of the Danish market will turn over 3 million euros, 22.5 million Danish crowns, and even more importantly, save the planet approximately 8.5 billion liters of water, 3 million kilo of CO2, and 2 million kilo of chemicals per month. The colleagues at the DBA Trendsales, Tissé and Sardar, they seem to have stagnated and are generally non-user-friendly, badly marketed and commercialized platforms with short-term revenue streams. So we are the ones that want to make secondhand unique, just as unique as art, culture, and music. Yeah. Value proposition. Sorry, I moved the slides, that's why I get a little confused. But talking about the finances, that was about the finances. So we'll earn this service fee of 15 Danish crowns. You got that? So the other competitors, they have a lot of commercials because that's their revenue stream, and then a bad freemium version so that they can push people into making a subscription. We won't need to do that because we will become a trading agency, another platform. So we are allowed to be an agent that takes 15 Danish crowns or 2 euros from the buyer. So we have tested on 500 young people that really love this product, and we love that we are finally ready to give tons of pre-loved fashion new lives. And regarding the team, so obviously ambitious visions require strong teams and the right network, and we are a team that kicks ass and that are kicking ass, and we basically got everything that we need except for money for the next 3 months to go full time, but let's leave it there. That's why Mikkel is in here, I guess. I guess from there on there's only one thing left to say. It's time that we start giving clothes new lives. It's time that the world get the flow in the ropes, as we say. Thanks to you.
Thanks. And there's no doubt that there's a big, great business case, because I know there's a guy called Anders, and he's the richest guy in Denmark. He's also going more into sustainable, and he's investing a bit to sustainability as well.
Yeah.
So how much, Jyske Købmandskab, it's a tricky one, but how far are you now? Are the test users now, or are you launching soon full scale, or how are you?
We have tested it on 500 users, and it turns out that that free products accidentally got a new life, although that we just tested it, but that's pretty cool. So right now, all of you guys can actually download the app from the App Store or Google Play, but be fast on doing it, because we are taking it back pretty soon, and then we're also on social medias and stuff like that, but we'll take it all back so that we'll make a hard release because throughout the summer, because it's you rather want the whole Denmark to talk about you for one day than you want a few people talk about you every single day.
Absolutely.
So that's how we'll do it, and so what we'll do to make traction is two of the guys in the team, the Lavits, as we call them, that's two young brothers, they are reseller managers. They are they are admins in a lot of Facebook groups with a total of 200 young Danes that buy and sell clothes, if not on a daily basis, then at least on a weekly basis. And as soon as we push it to them, then instantly we'll have at least 10,000 users, and that's enough to make traction. So from there on, then we have an agreement with Red Cross and Salvation Army that when we can, when we have data to database pricing, then that's really valuable for them, because there is a big need to database pricing right now, because the logic for a senior volunteer is, Ralph Lauren, what is that? That'll be some cheap stuff. H&M, you know what that is. That's the logic. So they really want to get it. And for us, that's a way to easily enter a new market, because obviously with marketplaces, you need content, critical content.
Yeah. So we just have a few seconds left. Can you say, what's your biggest wish now? Is it the smart money or any kind of money?
Yeah, it's any kind of money. Like we got all of the knowledge that we need, and I'm so lucky to have studied engineering down at the Aalborg University. So when solution or when issue comes, then we can crush that. Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Big thanks to Simon and his project.
Thank you, guys.